Hello, everybody. It's great to be here in London for the JUC 2015 Europe. What can I say? It's an honor to be speaking in a conference where Kosuke himself was speaking with all other wonderful speakers. I really feel humbled and lucky to be here. Thank you so much for coming for this talk. Great. A quick introduction. I'm Pradeepto Bhattacharya from Pune, a small city near Mumbai in India. I am the director of engineering for the company out there, MSys-Clogeny. I've been a contributor to open source projects since 2005. It's almost 10 years right now. That's the project KD. It's a Linux desktop. It's been there since 1996. I've contributed code to it. I have written a bunch of code. I have organized conferences in India. I found the community. Right now, I am serving as the board of director for the open source organization that is based out of Germany. It's the registration foundation is in Germany. Anyway, let's start. I'm a bit nervous. This is the biggest conference I've ever spoken in. So I'm a bit nervous, so bear with me. But I can assure you the topic is really good, very interesting. I have some demos and whatnot. Yeah, so let's start. I hope you all are excited. Can I have a raise of hands? Anyone who has worked with Mesos before? I've heard of Mesos? 1, 2, 3, awesome. 5, 6, awesome. Great, so good. So majority of people have not heard of Mesos or not used Mesos, perhaps. What I'll do is I'll create a problem statement that many of you Jenkins users might have seen or might have faced. I'm pretty sure you have if you have a large build queue and things like that. And based on the problem statement, I'll show how Mesos helps you solve that, at least to a degree or to a major degree. To understand that, I will explain Mesos. I'll explain Mesos itself, some concepts and whatnot. Yeah, so a quick round of agenda. As I said, we'll build up the problem statement. And it's always good to know why. I mean, why are we doing this talk? And what's the agenda? Instead of what, it's a why we should start with. So I will build up the problem statement. I'll tell you about what static partitioning is all about, the limitations when we scale using that. And then we go on to build our future build or test cluster using Mesos. I'll show you describe you the benefits of that and explain you the concepts and so on and so forth. And then using the Jenkins Mesos plugin, we will actually do something finally with demo. It's not listed, but I'll actually, because with the experience that I have gained while working with Mesos, Jenkins, and in general, I have found some gotchas. I'll share those with you. Those are basically some of the war stories that I can share with you. There are a few which might help you probably when you are using it yourself. Yeah, the story so far. Problem statement. This looks familiar, right? I mean, this is not just your build test cluster. This is just general your cluster. Maybe there's a web front end. There are DB servers. There are some background servers, maybe. And you have your, I mean, I've just put two nodes for the space and whatnot. But imagine it's we are concentrating on the Jenkins slave bit. You have your build and test cluster, and your developers are working, and they push code. Your tests are run. Your packages are built, and so and so forth. When that happens, what we generally see is, I'm guessing many of you have dedicated slaves to do iOS and Android builds. Some have some other builds to do RPM, maybe RPM or a package of your choice builds for those. Maybe there are some beefier machines to run your long-running tests or nightly builds and things like that, which run during the night, maybe, or in general. But you have a separate. So you have basically created some kind of partition around it, around your own infrastructure. So in most cases, what you will find that these nodes, these various nodes, are not interchangeable. we are not just talking, I mean, I did describe the test cluster a bit, but think about it. You have a DB node, you have a web worker node, or you have a background processor node. These things are not interchangeable, generally. I mean, unless you actually put in lots of effort to make sure that they are. And then it's like a management hell, to be honest. So what you have just heard is probably very familiar, and it's a severe case of static partitioning. You have partitioned your infrastructure statically into hard groups, if you may call that. There are a bunch of disadvantages with this strategy. Your infrastructure is not truly elastic. Elastic is not, I mean, often it is advertised as like, okay, if you can spin up a node with the press of a button or an API call, it's like you have another node and you can send another REST call and the node is terminated or stopped or some things like that. That's all fine, but those has its limitations. Let's see what are those. So you have X number of slaves or build in your build cluster. Tomorrow or someday, you need more slaves. What do you do? Put in more slaves or put in more nodes? Great. Then what? Build a beefier machine? Great. That will work, true. What if a week later or some other few time later, you need more CPU, more memory, more RAM, some other resource? Will you repeat your previous fix? Maybe you don't need that much. You need something less as well. So do you actually revert your fix? What do you do? How long can you do that? There will be a time when you will be constrained by either of these two things, machines or money. I mean, you can only bring up so many machines in so much time. That's a fact. And more so, I mean, we are not in a utopian world where we have infinite money that we can keep on bringing nodes and nodes and nodes. The money, someone will ask you the question, why are you burning money? Bringing up slaves after slaves after slaves. Maybe you have a really, really huge funded startup maybe, or somebody's putting in lots of money, and you have a large budget. Well, highly unlikely, but let's play with it. So you have many test slaves. Great. What do you do when you don't need them? You bring them down? You keep them running? If you keep them running, you are not utilizing. There was a great talk by Andrew about the 7 good habits of Jenkins. He said, he was talking about we should be curtailing the idle time of our nodes. We often see, I'll show you in a demo, and you have seen, if you have many executors, it says idle. Do you really want so many nodes on maybe a cloud or somewhere running and saying that they are idle right now? We will come to a situation where we will discuss the situations where they might be idle in a bit. So the nodes, when they are idle, they could be used somewhere else. Think about a situation in the evenings, maybe your developers are not working that time. And those nodes, and hence there are no commits to be pushed, there are no tests to be run, no packages to be built perhaps. As a result, those nodes will be your big funded cluster is basically sitting idle and doing nothing. Either way, with the static partitioning that I described some time back, we are not truly elastic. The utilization is not optimum. The efficiency, return of investment, whatever business words that people actually use, and they are important for people who are controlling the money, are not good. The finance department will definitely be not happy with your setup, as simple as that. Can we solve this problem? Yes, we can, in various ways. I'll present one problem, one solution, and in my opinion, it's really, really great solution because the ease of actually using it eventually. And I'll, as I said, the whole idea is to demo the whole thing. So I'll show it to you. I'll show you slaves coming up when there are no slaves at that point and whatnot in a bit. But the next thing, enter Apache Mesos. So let me tell, before I go into the concepts, and I'll go in quite a detail of the concepts so that you understand Mesos so well that, frankly, you start using it after the talk, maybe. Let me tell you a very brief history. It was written by a bunch of people along with Benjamin Hindman, a PhD candidate. That time he was completing doing his PhD from University of California in Berkeley. He and the AMP lab folks basically wrote this in C++. It's in C++. Now, since I think I counted like maybe 10 at most people who have used it, just to tell you, I mean, maybe the name is new. I can tell you Mesos has been there for almost 4 to 5 years, and it's production grade. If you are using Twitter, if you have used Airbnb to book a hotel to come to JUC 2015 London, then you have used Mesos without knowing it. The backends, the infrastructure for Airbnb, eBay, Netflix, Uber, and Twitter, of course, is Mesos, Apache Mesos, and some other things around Mesos. You can actually go to that link. I'll share my slides later, and you'll find a bunch of other companies, many of which we have never heard, are using Mesos in production grade. So it's not a toy software anymore. It's like it's a full grade. Apache graduate, totally fine. Apache blessed project. So yeah, if you want to use it for your Jenkins purposes, great. Or anything else, even awesome. So concepts. This is where things get interesting. What is Mesos? What does it do? How does it do? And things like that. You can basically think Mesos as an operating system or a kernel. Now, if you're using your laptop here, or maybe your phone, Android phone, each of it has like a kernel in it, a OS and a kernel. And this kernel makes sure that your applications don't need to know how to talk to your disk or your CPU or your RAM or anything. That's not how we write application. We just write the application. We do not tell, unless we are writing libraries, I'm talking about applications, we do not tell how to interface with the hardware. That's what OS does, because our application uses libraries. Libraries talk to the kernel API and things like that, and that does the hardware thing. In a multi-core machine, which probably every machine in this room has, even the phones probably, we don't tell our applications, go use CPU 1, CPU 3, or whatever number of core you have. We just say application, if it needs more cores, it will use it. It will know which core to use and things like that. Mesos is exactly like that. It's an operating system for your cluster. You saw the diagram that we had, lots of nodes on it. Yeah, that was your cluster. So in the progressive slides, you will see some diagrams, and I'll try and explain how that works. Look at this node. So on the left side, you see bunch of nodes, and they are individual nodes in your cluster. So there are like each machine has a varying capacity of CPU, RAM, disk, and whatnot. So that's your cluster, and if you want to use something, you just use it, and you have your scripts which manages where it should go to and whatnot. Using Mesos, you put a boundary around it, interestingly, and it becomes one large computer. That's interesting. Suddenly, instead of having one CPU, some GB RAM, and some hard disk, you have 14 CPU, 27 gig of RAM, 2,304 gigabytes of hard disk space, and things like that. So suddenly, you have this thing what can be termed as node abstraction. Your cluster with n nodes with varying capacities now has become one huge computer. But how will this work? The devil is in the details, as they say. And we will dive into it in a bit. So remember this old diagram from your old cluster? So this is the same thing. But as I said, I'll progressively improve on this to where we are reaching. This cluster, it is exactly the same cluster that we are looking at. Let's look at the next one. What happened here is, as I said, in the evenings, your developers probably will go out for drinks with their friends or be in the house with their family and things like that. Hopefully, they are not coding and having a happy life. and what they are doing. Well, coding is happy, but just saying, coding is happy, make no mistake. I love code. I write Python every day. So what they will do is they will not push code, hopefully. And when they're not pushing code, there is nothing to be checked. The jobs will not basically run because maybe you are polling the your version control gate or whatever. So at that point of time, you don't need as many slaves. This diagram is very, what shall I say, just for indication, don't think that you have just one slave. I'm just saying that you have n number of Jenkins nodes. But you don't need those n number of Jenkins nodes in the evenings or maybe during vacation time. How about Christmas when many countries go for this 5 to 6 between New Year and people are on a shutdown and people are not working, they are with their families. You don't need that many nodes. But at the same time, your services have not stopped. Maybe your online shop has not stopped. Maybe you have to send emails at the night, in the evenings. In fact, shopping has gone through the roof. It could very well be possible, right? Because lots of people are shopping during vacations for whatever reasons. And that time you need to process maybe images, you need to send emails, and so on and so forth. And that time you need that another node for background processor. So what Mesos will do is transparently, it will give one node back to the cluster, and that will be used wherever it is required. In this particular use case, it is the background processor. It could be completely something else, and we will see that. So what you just saw, because of this, the benefits are obvious. You get a better return of investment. You get better utilization because your nodes are not Jenkins nodes, and they are sitting idle, doing nothing, right? The whole thing is achieved in Mesos by isolation. It uses Linux C groups on the top of HDFS. These are Mesos specific details. If when you are using the plugin, you really need not worry about that immediately, unless you are doing something very you are going in depth. And then there is obviously higher efficiency. Great. So as I said, the devil is in details. Let's dig in. The components of Mesos. Every time you will touch Mesos, these components you will touch this. So be very listen very carefully about these things. In a Mesos cluster, there will be Mesos masters. Mesos by default is fault tolerant and works in a high availability mode, so it can have multiple masters. What Mesos master does is it talks to the slaves, it talks to the frameworks, and I'll come to what frameworks are in quite in detail. So that. Now the slaves are basically the worker nodes. If it's about running your test, building your packages, running some web service, running your Rails app, Python app, whatever it is, it's the nodes that will be the slaves that will be doing actual hard work. Masters are just telling them to do. Think masters as project leaders or managers, and the slaves are the actual workers. Then comes frameworks. As mentioned earlier, sometime back, if you remember, I said think Mesos as operating system. Now think about it. And when I say operating system, we generally think lots of things, a notepad, because they all come together, but it's actually the kernel that I'm talking about. With the kernel by itself on a machine, you can do only so much. You need applications. You need your chat application, you need your browser application, you need your word processors and things like that. Frameworks are those. In Mesos world, framework is nothing but a Mesos applications. That's what Mesos applications are called, frameworks. So as I said, we will go much in detail about frameworks because they are the crux of the story. So we'll come back to it in a bit. Zookeeper. How many of you have heard or used Zookeeper here? Quite a few, great. So Zookeeper is a tool, another Apache project. It is used to do service discovery and coordination between nodes and services. Mesos by default uses Zookeeper. In fact, last I checked, the Mesos source code has a check-in of Zookeeper, a particular version of Zookeeper. You are free to use it or not use it, but you cannot avoid Zookeeper if you're using Mesos. You need Mesos, the Zookeeper, to do all kind of coordination and whatnot. So what kind of coordination? I'll come to it in detail, but briefly, as I said, there will be multiple masters, so you need a leader election, you need coordination between in the master and slaves, you also need to tell the slaves which is the current leader and things like that. Zookeeper does that. Yeah. So this is a wonderful diagram that you get from the Mesos website as well. Nothing I created. So what you have is multiple masters, and you have a Zookeeper quorum. So quorum is the value that you need, minimum number of masters to be running for the cluster to be working properly. So if you have three, generally you keep a quorum of two. If you have five masters, then you keep quorum of five. So these are settings that you can do when you are configuring your Mesos. So that's the Zookeeper quorum, Mesos, and then there are slaves. You can see something very interesting, two words that you will see very prominently and multiple times, executors and schedulers. Those are part of framework, and we will, as I said, I'm building up to it. So yeah, the next bit, actually. Mesos applications are called frameworks. This is where it gets interesting. So frameworks run on the top of Mesos itself. So Mesos comes with a bunch of APIs that you can write. You can write your programs in Go, Python, C++, and whatnot. It gives you an API to write frameworks. So these applications, they consist of two components. One is a scheduler and an executor. The scheduler is responsible for registering with the master, the Mesos master. The framework scheduler, we will see a bunch of frameworks, at least I'll show you, and obviously we'll talk about the Jenkins framework as well. So when a framework is loaded, it needs to register with the Mesos master. That's what it does, the scheduler. It is also responsible for accepting the offers that it gets from the Mesos masters. It's called the resource offers, and in a bit. That's the most interesting thing, or rather a different design of Mesos compared to other schedulers. I'll come to it. Executors are simple processes that run on the slave node, which do the actual work. So if you are running a task, it's the executor that will execute the task on the slave. This is where we will see how the communication is done. So scheduler and executor both together form the slave. What happens is, whenever there is a slave that has free resources, maybe it has finished its tests or it has just come online. Sorry. Either ways, that slave advertises its resources, CPU, RAM, disk space, ports, to the master, the Mesos master. Mesos master takes it from there and says, OK, it talks to the frameworks. It could be various frameworks, Jenkins framework, Hadoop framework, Spark framework, and so on and so forth. It gives those offers. Here, framework, this is the CPU I have on this slave. This is the RAM that I have. And a framework at that point can choose to accept the offer or reject the offer. Why should it reject the offer? Maybe it doesn't need it. For example, if there is no build to be tested or built or whatever, there is no need for a Jenkins slave, as I said. So the framework will reject the offer. There could be another reason it could reject an offer. Suppose there is a test that needs so much of RAM, so much of disk, and whatnot, some requirement. And the offer that has gone from the Mesos master to the framework is less than that. It says, nothing doing. I'm not going to work. Give me a better slave. It is so good. This two-way scheduling is called the resource offer, and that's the crux of it. The two-way part is the master does not decide, OK, here's work. Go do it. The master sends an offer. The framework has all the right to reject or accept it. Once it has accepted it, though, then it sends the description, the scheduler sends the description of the task to the master. And the master takes the description of the task and sends it back to the executor and runs it. While all this happening, the executor sends in some check-in messages, OK, this is the test status, and the master sends it back to the scheduler. This is all taken care of by Mesos. You do not need to program it yourself if you're using the existing frameworks and whatnot. Let's see which are the famous, which are the frameworks. Here are three. The first one is very familiar, at least here, very, very familiar. That's the Jenkins framework. Then there is Hadoop framework, there is Spark framework, there are many more. When I say a Jenkins framework, the Jenkins plugin for the Mesos plugin for Jenkins is the Jenkins framework. You do not need to do anything special. We'll come to it about the installation and things like that in a bit, which is as easy as installing any other plugin. So these are the frameworks. This is a very beautiful diagram by the folks from the good folks from Mesosphere. They are a startup based out of, I think, San Francisco, who have been basically building lots and lots of tools around Mesos. You see MA, that's Marathon. That's one of the things that they have built. And all the other plugins, the frameworks that you see, they are all mostly open source contributed by various companies. For example, if I'm not mistaken, Kronos is contributed by Airbnb. Jenkins came out of Twitter, and then it's been taken over. It has been eBay folks have been contributing to it a lot. There are other frameworks as well. We really do not need to go into it. I will talk about Marathon in a bit because we can use Jenkins with Marathon, and we can solve certain other problems as well. But that's much later in the task. So let's talk about the Jenkins plugin now. So I'm very close to the demo. So I've been talking a lot, and I'm really, really excited about the demo. Hopefully it will work. Yeah, you have no idea how much effort it has gone, not from my side, but from the people out there manning this thing. They had to put in cable for this. So thanks to Tom and Elizabeth and everybody else. They really did a hard work. Yeah, please. So this plugin, I will get to the demo, but installing part, I'll not show. I'm telling you why, because you just need to go to the plugin management page and just say Mesos and done with it. The only gotcha about it is the latest plugin 0.7 gave me some trouble. So I uninstalled it, and I went back to old plugin. See, Andrew's wise words, if you attended 7 Habits of Mesos, go back to old plugins, stay there, and stay with the stable versions and things like that. I faced some problem. I'm not saying you will face some problem. So all the demo that I will show are with the latest version of Jenkins when I downloaded it a few days back. But the plugin is 0.6. Oops. Yeah, thanks. So let me show you how Mesos. Can all of you read this, or should I increase the font size maybe? Any show of hands if you want me to increase the font size? OK, great. I need to. Let's see how to do that. Good? Give me a thumbs up or something like that. Awesome. Thank you. So another thing that I'm not going to show, but I can talk about it after the talk. I'm here for today and tomorrow. If you want to talk about how to install or configure Mesos, I am totally available for you guys to talk about it. The most simplest way is to just install the available package for the system of your choice. If it's a Ubuntu or a Debian machine, just do apt-get install. If it's a CentOS machine, just do a yum install. Update your source.list or things like that, and it should work. The interesting part is the configuration of Mesos and the slaves. As I said, I can talk about it. We can take this offline, but there is lots to do in it. It's mostly grunt work. Ideally, you will use some chef recipes. There are available chef recipes for that, or Puppet recipes, or any tool that you prefer. Plus, at the end of the slide, I will share some links. I have, I think, written 2 blogs about how to configure, how to manage a Mesos cluster in general, nothing to do with Jenkins per se. You can read those, and I think those will be suffice. But once you have a Mesos cluster running, this is how it will look. So I'm running a Vagrant-based system on my machine. I think I'm running 3 slaves, 2 masters, 1 separate Jenkins master on my machine right now with various configurations, and I'll talk about those. When you see, when you run this, what you will see is, as I said, I'm running 3 or 4 machines. I said I am running 3 slaves. You can see I'm running 3, it says 3 slaves are activated, none are deactivated. It says I'm totally running 6 CPUs, 6.2 GB of RAM, and so on and so forth. 6 CPUs because each of my slaves has 2 cores. And RAM, I have configured it such a way for the demo purposes that 2 of those machines are give you larger, I mean, they give, the VM itself has been configured with 4 GB RAM and 2 CPUs, but 1 slave is much smaller. I think it is just 512 or just 1 GB RAM because I want to show you certain part of the demo, how you can use it. And how you can create a heterogeneous network, and how you can direct your jobs there, and things like that. Anyway, so that's your Mesos dashboard in general. You also have things like frameworks. So I am already running Jenkins framework because I've installed the plugin. Once the plugin is installed and I have configured it correctly, it registers itself as one of the frameworks. Ignore the Marathon framework for now. It's there because I have installed it, but I'm not going to show it as a part of the demo, but we'll talk about it. There is also information about slaves. These are my slaves. It's kind of the similar data out here, and offers. So you will see, if you see long enough after waiting, you'll see the offered, these things are all reactive, so they will keep changing as things happen. Now that's the Mesos part, and let's go to Jenkins. This is your standard Jenkins, but what I will do is, it's slightly difficult because I have to read from there and then click on it. I'm sorry about it, I'll be a bit slow here. Am I on manage Jenkins? Yes. So the plugin installation part is, never mind. OK, I can't even click now. Holy crap. Oh, come on. Ah, thank God. So what you see is this bit. Once you have installed this plugin, there's this section called as cloud, and this thing is not shown at that point. You have to enable as Mesos cloud. Once you enable it, you see this part. Now, look at the, I don't think this is readable, right? Can everybody read this, or should I zoom in? Okay. Can you read it now? Okay, so as I said, my configuration is this. There is 1 Jenkins master. There are 2 Mesos masters, 3 slaves. Jenkins master is not part of the Mesos cluster. But when you are running it this way, you need to install Mesos on the machine where your Jenkins is running, because you need the access to that library. But you don't need to run the Mesos slave or Mesos master daemons. All you need to do is install it. After that, you need to give a path to Mesos. This is a zookeeper path. Since I initially had three masters, you see three different IPs and the port on which the zookeeper clients work on. So, and then there's this Mesos endpoint. So it could be just one master in your case, so it will be just one IP. The description part is description. You just put some text. The framework name, this is by default, it comes as Jenkins scheduler. The slave name, slave username Jenkins, this is interesting. If when you are creating your slaves, make sure it has the user created with the same name that you are using in your Jenkins master to run Jenkins. So if you, on your Jenkins master, if you're running Jenkins as Jenkins user, all your slaves need to have the Jenkins user. So it's just a user add on a Linux machine or add user on a Linux machine, and you create that node. And the Jenkins home should be set as well. Having said that, you can have authentication. I've never played with it, but with framework principle and framework secret, you can actually have some kind of authentication. This is the bare bones configuration you need to do, but this is just about Mesos configuration, not the slave configuration yet. That's part of the advanced section. When I click on it, So what you see here is checkpointing, first of all. So Mesos, I think sometime a year back, if I'm not mistaken, has, because there are multiple masters, multiple slaves, things may go down at those places as well. It has built-in checkpointing system. So it will, if a slave goes down, it can resume the task from that point. So your Jenkins plugin also, or the Jenkins framework also supports that. So if you enable it, it will basically save some work later on if a particular slave goes down in the middle of a job and things like that. On-demand framework registration, that it will register the framework only when there is a requirement. I found it a little bit weird when I was using it, so I have disabled it for now. And this is the part, this part is where you actually define what kind of slaves you want. As I said, in the initial part, when you have static partitioning, you have this is a beefier machine, this is an iOS machine, this is some other machine, and things like that. Or these are kind of machines where you can have your RPMs built. As a result, you have probably whatever RPM build or whatever tools you need. So this is where you define your slave. So anybody who has used Jenkins and has some slaves, I'm sure you have seen that label parameter plugin, where you can have labels to your slaves, and then you can restrict your jobs to that. We will use the same fundamental here. You have a label string. It's a user-defined name. You could have given anything. Then you give what amount of CPU you want for this particular type of slaves. I have just given it 0.5% or 0.5 of a one CPU. So it's like half the CPU or something like that. Then I have to give what kind of memory I need for the slave memory, the number of executors I want, the executor CPU amount. This adds up, by the way, 0.5 and 0.5. Similarly, the executor memory, 128 MB RAM, so 256 and 128 add up. So this is and then there is remote FS root. I just kept it Jenkins. I've never changed it, but you can actually have your customized home as far as I have read about it. I've never used it again. And you can give ideal termination minutes. So if your slave is not doing, your Jenkins slave, not the Mesos slave, your Jenkins slave is not doing something for a certain amount of time, it will just say, OK, I'm not doing anything, and the slave will go down. The Jenkins slave will go down. The Mesos slave won't. Make no way. And you can give some parameters here. The interesting thing to note here is what Mesos plugin does is it triggers the slave using GNLP and at a particular port. And we'll discuss about ports and things like that at the end of the slide. So this is how I define one type of slave. I have a few more slaves, but let's see. What you see here is the build executor status. The two ideal slave executors that you see are the master executors. You don't see any slaves, right? You don't see any slaves, any Jenkins slaves or anything. If you had multiple nodes, If you had configured nodes, you would see a bunch of nodes, right? But before that, let me show you the job configuration. As I said, the job configuration is this configure? No. Is as simple as just say, restrict this job to Mesos Jenkins. That's about it. The name that I had given in that other page. Remember that? So that's all. Now, let me do a build now. Let's see what happens. Can you guys read it? Maybe I need to increase the font again. See what's happening. It says it's waiting for next available executor. This is where generally the demos fail. Oh, so it says it's found a slave. Now, interestingly, here, this was empty, right? Until now. It is a new slave just popped up on my network. And it says, so what just happened was, Mesos Jenkins plugin realized, oh, I need to execute a task. Great, I don't have a slave running. There were two executors, but those are not of Mesos Jenkins label parameter. So I need to spawn them. What it just did was, it spawned this is the nodes page that you would see if you have a bunch of nodes. This is a page, a familiar page. So it just spawned that node. That node wasn't there some time back. I'll show it to you because it will, again, go away. So this job just got over as well because it's a very, very small job. All it does is prints a line. I'll show you. So if I wait for long enough, this thing will go away. And this will say it's still running because the task is running according to it. The task is actually the slave that is running here. In a bit, this will go down as one of the completed tasks. And what you will see is here in Jenkins, you see this is idle. After some time of idle period, this will go away. What you just saw was there were no slaves, no Jenkins slaves, and you suddenly had a slave. It did its work. After some time, it went away. You did not have, beyond your ideal point of time, you did not burn any resources. You just had add this thing. But if it's a, I have a, the configuration that I showed. Now I have a large requirement for a large, beefier machine to run some better test or some processing and things like that. Here I have given more memory and things like that. Now, in the configuration that I showed you here of my slaves, I know that 10.10.20.52 is one of the machines which has very less memory. You can actually see that. Every time I send a job, the simple job, it can go to either of these three. But every time I send the beefy job, it will always go to either 51 or 50 because that's where the resource offer is satisfied. Remember I told you the resource offer, a framework can reject. So Mesos will actually send out, okay, here's an offer. But they say, oh, it has less RAM, I'll not work with you. So it will actually go to some other where the other thing. So the interesting part is if I start this job, and the same time, I start this job, See, this one is not there because this layer, there was some idle time, we were talking, and this died down, right? In a bit, you should see another node coming up soon, I think, unless this one takes care of both of them. It shouldn't. Yep. So two different nodes running because I'm running two different jobs. The beautiful part of the demo is my jobs are not polling, not on some time period. So if I change it to every 2 minutes or something, because the beefier job takes at least 3 minutes, I'm doing a sleep, nothing more than that. You will actually see after a period of time, the other slave also, the other slave as in the actual slave, actually also gets spawned off, and the we actually keep seeing too many slaves. So we not too many slaves, we just see whatever is required. So this job already got over. So at this point, if I spawn another one, so this will wait for a certain time because it's trying to talk to the same slave because there is a slave with Mesos large configuration. And because it's not accepting it because this one is running, in a bit it will just go to, that's how I have configured it, and the, because of the limitations of my laptop and my configuration. So if you, you will see that in a bit it will spawn the other node that is the third slave or the first slave rather, and it spawns a job there. You keep on doing it, and you'll keep seeing that these jobs, after they are done, they finish off very nicely. Now, how do you control things like, now in my, on my machine, what I'm doing is running all of them as Ubuntu machines. What if you need an RPM slave or things like that? You can control them. So this will take some time because of the other thing. Can we go back to the slides, please? Yeah. Yeah. So, as I said, maybe you can give characteristics to your slave. Maybe it's an CentOS node or things like that. Mesos gives you the facility of things called as resources and attributes per slave. You can run, you can use this as a command line parameter when you are running the slave daemon. If you pass these, if you pass things this way, this, what happens is Jenkins, there was a section in the configuration, slave configuration, where it could accept a certain type of parameter. If it sees in the offer there is a key value pair OS CentOS, only then the RPM job, build job will be going to there, that particular slave. Similarly, you can set other characteristics, including how much RAM you want to give and things like that. Quickly, I'll do the strategies. I am running Jenkins separately, and there's this the slave network in Mesos network. There's a problem with that. Jenkins master is single point of failure in that case. If Jenkins master goes down, your slaves are good for nothing. I mean, there's a beautiful cluster which comes up, comes down. But so that's a problem. So you have to have some kind of script that will bring up your Jenkins master again or things like that. Or you could run it via Marathon. Marathon is the initd of Mesos world. It basically is used to run any long-running process. If you run the Jenkins master via Marathon, you have Jenkins master in the cluster itself. But there is a there are gotchas to it. You have to take care of where your Jenkins home is. Maybe you want a shared folder because your Jenkins master might come up in a different node. Or you might restrict which node. We just saw we can restrict it by giving attributes and things like that. You can restrict it to a node. These are the few gotchas that I said I'll discuss. If you are running any framework or Jenkins outside the cluster, sometimes you will see that the framework is registering itself with the master at 127.0.0.1 IP as a home, private IP. Those times, to make sure the slaves, masters, and frameworks talk to each other, you have to use the live process IP. You just have to set that variable, environment variable on your system before triggering the comment. So what I have done is I've set that IP, and I've done Jenkins master, Java Jenkins war. I've run Jenkins. You have to be careful of what ports you are blocking and your firewall settings. As I said, JNLP is used with a certain port. make sure you have your firewall configured correctly. The other thing is dirty slaves. Now that you have one big cluster and machines where things can be working, things will be run, maybe your applications will be deployed and tested. You might get dependency problems, stale stuff. So one solution is to use containers like Docker or something else. Mesos by itself actually uses C groups, but for your that's for its own process isolation and things like that. But for your build test runs, you can easily use Docker. In fact, you can when you are configuring your slave, you can configure to use the native containerization, or you can use Docker. I would strongly recommend reading some of there's a very detailed Mesos paper by the people who did the PhD. Plus the blogs that I have written, and there is this last two blogs by eBay folks. I think that's the gold standard of what I'm trying to explain. They have done it very well and much detailed. But if you want to do bare bones, understand bare bones Mesos so that you can use it with your Jenkins net cluster, then I would suggest the two blogs that you build your own data center and this thing. I would like to thank the organizers here. They have been more than helpful. They have been really kind to me. My folks at home and my office people, and especially the last two people, I've been doing CI/CD with Girija and Rupali for the last 4 years. I've learned a lot from them. Finally, the Manning people they have been writing this book. They have been kind enough to give me this coupon. You can ask me later on as well. Until June 30, you get 50% off on this book. It's in progress, so you don't have the full book. It's in progress, so you can use that whenever you want. I don't think we have time for questions, do we? One question? No? OK. We can talk offline. We can talk outside about anything. And as I said, I can show you the configuration and things like that. Thank you so much.